Good evening, everyone, and welcome to First Aid AMC Clinical free 2-week session again. I hope that you guys are doing well, and I'm sure that you guys did our last session with Dr. Cynthia. I hope that you enjoyed the session, and you must have got the recording of the class in your Facebook group as well, right? And those of you who are in our course already, you must be getting it in our portal. So tonight we are going to start with another kind of cluster, which is cardiology. Cardiology cluster is a part of your medicine preparation. So basically you're going to learn today how to approach a case from medicine, right? And cardiology is one of the most important from medicine. A lot of questions come from here. Before I start, do you guys have any question that you want to ask? Because I'm still waiting for others to join, so I can just talk to you if you want, or also if there is any question about the course, anything that you are confused about, you can always ask me at the end as well, okay? As part of the class requirement, what we normally do is that we put you muted during the class, so that like sometimes people join in the middle of the class and someone is talking behind. So it becomes a little bit noisy around the class. So we keep you muted for the duration of the class, but you can always write your questions in the Zoom chat box. And also if you are in Facebook, you can also write it in the comment section. We normally don't take classes on Facebook apart from this free 2-week session. So once this 2-week session is done, then only the classes will be on Zoom. So if you're already enrolled in the course, I would suggest you to come and join us in the Zoom so that you know how to use it, okay? All right, so let's start our tonight's session then. You guys can hear me properly, there is no problem. Great. So cardiology, right? So in cardiology, we divide cardiology in few clusters. One of the cluster is syncope cluster. Then we will have your palpitation or nervousness cluster. We will have chest pain cluster. Those are the most three clusters that we are going to do with cardiology. So we divide the cardiology class into two sessions so that you get an idea. Normally we don't need to take a lot of time for these clusters, but initially for the 1 month, you will need a little bit time to understand the approach. Once you understand the approach, we can be a little bit more faster. So don't think that this is the pace of our regular classes. This is actually for the beginning time. So for beginners, we start slow, but after a month, we usually will be a little bit more faster so that we can finish your course in the due time. Okay, so learn the approach because you can use this approach in almost every medicine cases. So learning the approach, learning the format is the most crucial part. You will find out today that how we use one format to solve 6 or 7 cases. And it becomes so easier for everyone to remember in this way. So that's what we call as cluster-wise approach. So let's start the syncope cluster. So what are the differential diagnoses for a patient who is coming to you with a sudden loss of consciousness or syncope? So we think about mostly cardiovascular related, CNS related, or some miscellaneous or others. CVS related, it could be arrhythmia, could be aortic stenosis, would be HOCM, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Syncope can be a presentation of myocardial infarction or ischemic heart disease as well. Sometimes prolonged QT syndrome, which is basically a part of arrhythmia, also can come as a syncope. So usually in the exam cases, think about aortic stenosis because this is also a handbook case and also very important for exam. HOCM, not very important. myocardial infarction does not come as a syncope most of the time in exam, but mostly as a chest pain. But still, you should rule that out. Think about prolonged QT syndrome, especially in a young patient. There is a possibility. Then come for the CNS-related causes. It could be a stroke or TIA, could be head injury, infection, or epilepsy. Most of the time, when we come to the CNS differential, I always remember by like four specific causes: trauma, tumor, infection, head injury. So you will find that most of the differential diagnoses from CNS get covered with four or five diseases. So trauma, tumor, infection, stroke. Okay. Then others. Others also very important to rule out, especially vasovagal syncope is a very important case for exam. Postural hypertension also important, can be hypoglycemia related. Anemia can cause syncope. Some medication, especially if a patient taking polypharmacy and a couple of them are volume depleting drugs like diuretics, ACE inhibitors, those can cause syncope. Then sometimes, not very common, but stress or psychogenic cause can be a possibility. So stress can do a lot of mysterious thing to a person. We should always rule out psychological issue in any of these medical related causes, okay? So CNS, CVS, and others, these are the differential diagnoses. The most important part of your any kids or any cluster is to learn about the differential diagnosis as much as possible. Because if you know the differential diagnosis, then you can easily finish your history and examiner becomes very happy if you ask a lot of differential in the exam. So in the first 1 minute time, sorry, in the first 2 minute time in the outside, when you get your question, hello everyone. I think some of the network dropped. Can you guys hear me now? Okay, sorry for that. Sorry, we are having a little bit of network issue because it's raining around me. So sometimes during raining time, the network plays a little bit, but usually it should be fine. If it happens again, then we'll see that if there is anything we can do about it. Okay, so we're discussing about the differential diagnosis of syncope. So we discussed about CVS causes, we discussed about CNS causes and others. In the others, mainly vasovagal, postural, hypoglycemia, anemia, medication, and stress. For the purpose of exam, the cases that usually come in exam is aortic stenosis, then prolonged QT syndrome, vasovagal syncope, postural hypertension. These are the most important cases for syncope. There are a couple of others which we will come across. So how we are going to take a history for someone who come to you as a syncope, right? Syncope is usually a sudden onset thing. Anything which is very recent onset, we always make sure that patient is vitally stable or not before taking the history. So how we normally start a medicine history, that's how you are going to do. So let's say a patient coming to you, like a 50-year-old, and he was playing football or playing tennis with a colleague, and suddenly he lost consciousness. And he's here to discuss about it. Your task might be taking a history, take physical examination from examiner, and give your diagnosis and DD. So the history part, what happens in the exam that once your 2 minute time is up, I'm talking about the face-to-face. So you go into the exam room, the examiner will stand in front of the room and ask for your ID. So he will take your ID. There will be an ID card hanging around your neck. So you will show your ID card. Examiner will see that if it is correct. And then they will say that this is your patient, Sam, you can start. You thank the examiner and you go in and sit in the chair or maybe sit beside the couch if patient is lying down. And then you start your history taking. So always make sure when you go in and examiner introduce yourself with the patient, you should always talk to the patient first before you are asking for hemodynamic stability. So you go in and say, "Hi, Sam, this is Dr. X. I'm one of the doctor in this emergency." Or you always know from the question that is it a GP setting or it's a ED setting. So depending on that, you can say that if it's a GP setting, you will say, "Hi, Sam, this is Dr. Arshan. I'm one of the GP in this clinic. It's very nice to meet you." And then the patient, they give some time for the patient to say, "Hello, doctor, thank you." Okay, sometimes candidates just talk and talk. They don't even give the patient time to say hello back to you. So give some time. Patient says, "Hi, doctor, thank you for seeing me today. Well, Sam, I understand from the notes that you had an event last, or you can say that, Sam, I can understand from the note that you lost your consciousness yesterday while you were playing tennis with your colleague. I'm very sorry to hear that, Sam, but please don't get scared because right now you are here with me and I'm going to take care of you. But even before asking you any more questions, I would like to make sure you are vitally stable. So please excuse me for a moment. I will talk to my examiner and come back to you." You turn your chair towards the examiner and say, "Examiner, can I please," or you can say, "Dear examiner, I want to make sure if my patient is vitally stable for further history." Or, "Dear examiner, I would like to know if my patient is vitally stable for further history." Examiner might say, "Your patient is stable, go for your task." Examiner can say that, "What do you want to know?" If examiner say, "What do you want to know?" then you ask the examiner that, "I would like to know the blood pressure in both standing and sitting position, pulse with rate and rhythm." Always two questions at a time from examiner. Examiner will give you the value, and then you ask three other vitals, which is temperature, saturation, and respiratory rate. So when you ask vitals from the examiner, there are five things that we look for: blood pressure, pulse, respiratory rate, temperature, and oxygen saturation. Okay? But always two at a time. Maybe you can ask blood pressure and pulse, and then three together: respiratory rate, temperature, and oxygen saturation. But in cardiovascular, we always ask blood pressure in both standing and sitting position because we want to rule out postural hypotension, and pulse regular or irregular because we want to rule out any arrhythmia. Okay? Once examiner say that, "Yes, your patient is stable," then you go that, "Thank you, dear examiner." You turn towards the patient and say, "Thank you, Sam, for waiting. Now that I'm sure that you are stable, would you please tell me a little bit more about what exactly happened yesterday?" Which we call as HOPC, history of presenting complaint. Presenting complaint means what is the main presentation for this patient? And in this case, it's loss of consciousness, right? So we always start with an open-ended question. What exactly happened? Can you please tell me? Because when you ask an open-ended question, a lot of information patient will give it to you, which if you don't, if you just ask some closed-ended question, you might miss some important information which patient could give you if you ask an open-ended question. So always in the history, your first question should be an open-ended question. So can you please tell me a little bit more about what exactly happened? For syncope cluster, we divide the presenting complaint into pre-syncope, syncope, and post-syncope. So what happened before syncope, during syncope, and what happened after syncope. So patient will give you the information that, "Well, doctor, I was playing tennis with my colleague. I played three times, and then suddenly I just felt a little bit of off, and then I lost, or then I collapsed." Okay, so you will just find out what exactly happened in detail. ask them that, is it for the first time? Patient might say yes or no. If it is not the first time, you will need to dig in at, well, if it is not for the first time, how many times it happened so far? Can you tell me those incidents a little bit more in detail? So you get an idea that what making this syncopal attack to bring. So we need to find out that if there is any particular situation or anything particularly causing this syncopal attack or not. Once you have done that, then you can ask that, did you fall suddenly or did you feel any symptoms before fall? Especially, did you feel lightheadedness or dizziness? Why we ask this question is that cardiogenic syncope happens suddenly. Patient does not know that they are going to fall. Whereas if it is a vasovagal syncope or reflex syncope, those usually happens with some prodromal feature, especially lightheadedness, dizziness, they get sweaty, blurring of vision. So some prodromal symptoms will be there before they are falling. So we are just asking this question for that. So did you fall suddenly or did you feel any lightheadedness or dizziness before you fall? Ask some other question, that any headache, any blurring of vision, any weakness in any part of the body before you fall. So we are just finding out that, was there any prodromal symptoms happened before syncope? After that, we go to the syncopal attack. Now, because when patient lost consciousness, then patient will not be able to say what happened after that, right? So just for that, we sometimes ask that, was there any witness when you lost consciousness? Obviously, if patient was playing with a colleague, the colleague will be the witness. So you can ask the patient that, well, if you give me the consent, I would like to confirm what happened after you lost consciousness with your colleague. You can't do anything about it because in the exam, there will be only one role player, but it's just a protocol to say that you would like to ask questions from the witness. And then you can ask that, did you lose consciousness? If yes, then how long did you lose consciousness? Does your colleague informed you, or did your colleague inform you that you had some jerking movements? Did you wet yourself or pass a stool? Did you bite your tongue? And did you injure your head? So why we are asking this question? We need to know that if it is just a pre-syncopal attack or not, or if it is a syncopal attack, because to be a syncope, patient needs to lose consciousness. So we are confirming that, did you lose consciousness? If yes, how long? We're trying to rule out epilepsy by asking jerking movement, wetting yourself, passing a stool, and biting your tongue. And head injury is very important because when someone fall, they can hit their head on the ground. So always we rule out this possibility. Then you go to the post-syncope. After you gained your consciousness, were you able to stand by yourself or someone need to help you? Why? Because some causes will make the patient very confused and drowsy, and they will not be able to stand by themselves. Whereas if it is a cardiogenic syncope, patient lose consciousness suddenly and also regain consciousness suddenly. And patient does not get confused or drowsy after that. So that's why we're asking it. Did you feel confused and drowsy? If yes, then how long that confusion persisted? Any weakness or any problem with your vision or speech? Why we are asking this weakness, vision, speech problem? To rule out the CNS cause, especially TIA or a stroke. Okay, so this is pre-syncope, syncope, and post-syncopal questions. Once we have done that, then we move towards the differential diagnosis question. So we have CVS related differential. For CVS, you have like, you want to rule out ischemic heart disease or MI, you want to rule out arrhythmia, you want to rule out Hookah, you want to rule out aortic stenosis, right? So ask about any chest pain, any difficulty breathing, any racing of your heart. That will cover almost every CVS related symptom. How? Because the aortic stenosis, the triad of aortic stenosis is that patient get chest pain or tightness, especially during exertion. They get shortness of breath on exertion, and also they get syncopal attack. So that's the triad of aortic stenosis. For arrhythmia, you are asking racing of the heart. For MI or ISD, you are asking chest pain, difficulty breathing. So it covers everything. Then for CNS, if you did not ask head injury before, then ask here that any head injury recently, any fever, rash, neck stiffness. That's to rule out infection. You already ruled out stroke or TIA. You already ruled out head injury. You already ruled out epilepsy. Only thing that is still you haven't asked is about infection, which is meningitis or encephalitis. Then we have some other causes. So for hypoglycemia, did you skip your meal before you had this incident? Sometimes patient can skip their meal and then do overexertion. They become hypoglycemic and then they can have a syncopal attack. So did you skip your meal before this incident? For vasovagal syncope, there is not much of a question that you can ask. You can only ask that, was it a hot, sunny day when you lost your consciousness? Because if a patient exerting in a hot, sunny day or hot, sunny weather, sometimes they can have this vasovagal syncope. What happens in vasovagal syncope is that if someone stands for a prolonged period of time, especially in a hot sunny weather where they become dehydrated, their vagus nerve gets stimulated. The vagus nerve is supposed to cause peripheral vasodilation. So all excuse me. So all the bloods get pulled in the lower extremity. And if bloods are pulling in the lower extremity, what will happen? There will be lack of blood flowing into the brain. And if brain is not getting enough blood supply, you get kind of dizzy and sometimes even lose consciousness. So that's a vasovagal syncope. You just ask the patient that, was it a hot sunny day or were you standing for a long time? If patient was playing, you can ask that, were you playing for a long time? So that's what you can ask. For postural hypotension means that they feel dizzy or lightheadedness when they change their position from sitting to a standing position. So ask the patient, do you feel dizzy when you get up from the bed in the morning? Okay. For anemia, do you feel tired and fatigued these days? You can also ask that, like, did someone say that you look pale these days? For psychogenic, any stress at your home or work? Any other known past medical history, especially diabetes, high blood pressure, or any heart condition? We always finish with these three questions in the history. One is past medical history, SADMA, and family history. So in the past medical history, you just ask any relevant history, like for cardiovascular, we want to know diabetes, hypertension, and heart condition. For SADMA, there is a lot of thing in the SADMA, but we only ask smoking, alcohol, and medication. So do you smoke or drink alcohol? Do you take any regular medication? Any family history of sudden death, especially from any heart condition? Any family history of any specific heart disease? Why we ask family history of sudden death? Sudden cardiac death suggests the possibility of HOCM, HOCM, so hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. A lot of time they will give you a history that someone in the family died of very early for some heart condition. So that's sudden cardiac death. You can also get sudden cardiac death history in case of prolonged QT syndrome, especially congenital prolonged QT syndrome, okay? So that will be your history for syncope. Any question in the history? And Dr. Hemal, we don't need to ask about aura particularly in here. You can just ask about any blurring of vision, any slurring of speech. Did you get shaky in the hand or sweaty? Those are the important questions for prodromal symptoms. And Dr. Rao, it's not needed to directly ask the vitals, because many times we have seen that examiner just say, stick to your task, or examiner say, your patient is stable. Your patient is stable, go forward. So you don't need to ask directly. You can just ask that, is my patient vitally stable, for further history. Now, time to time, you will find out in many other notes or courses that they show you to say that, is my patient hemodynamically stable? Now, that's also from Karen notes, which is you can say decades older. So I would always suggest you don't just use same things, because if you use same things, then it becomes same for the examiner also. So just don't say hemodynamic stability. Ask in this way, I would like to know if my patient vitally stable for further history. That's a little bit the same thing, but we are asking in a different way. If vital is given in the history, you don't need to ask it again. That's also an important thing, Dr. Nandita, that always remember, if something is given in the history, don't bother to ask it, especially the vitals, because it shows that it means that you are not actually, you haven't read the question properly. And they become very, very unhappy about it, that something written in the exam question is still this candidate asking about it, means that that candidate did not even read the question properly. So that was your face-to-face approach. What if you are going for an online exam? So online exam, everything is same. Okay? In online exam, there will be no examiner in the video. So that's a video session. In the video, you will have an invigilator who will conduct the exam. There will be a role player on the video. There will be examiner, but examiner does not talk to you and you will not be able to see the examiner. So never ask anything to the examiner in online exam, which is different in face-to-face, because in face-to-face, you can see the examiner and you can ask everything. Not everything, just the relevant one. In online exam, most of the time vital will be given in your question. If not, then it becomes tricky because you are not asking it to the examiner, right? So you can always say that, hi, Sam, this is Dr. Arshan. I'm one of the GP in this clinic. It's very nice to meet you. I got to know from the notes that you lost your consciousness while playing with your colleague yesterday. I'm very sorry to hear that. How are you feeling now? Yes, doctor, I'm feeling good. Well, Sam, because you lost your consciousness, I would just like to make sure you are vitally stable before asking you any question. Is that okay with you? Yes, doctor. Now, the problem in here that you can't actually ask it to the examiner, so you just pretend that you have asked. So it's all about pretending in the exam. So you already say that you would like to check the vitals. That will make the examiner give a tick that, yes, this examinee wants to check the vitals. So you get a tick and you are fine. And then you can just say I would like to make sure your vital is stable before asking you any history. And after that, you just say that, well, now would you please tell me a little bit more about what exactly happened yesterday? Okay, so that's how you just do it in the online exam. Any question about it? And Dr. Jarin, should we ask vitally stable or should we ask separately? It depends that initially you would say that, well, I would like to know if my patient vitally stable for further history. If examiners say that, what do you want to know? Then you can ask separately pulse, blood pressure, and all other things. Any question for someone who are in the Facebook, you can always write it in the comment section. So let's move forward. So this is your history format, which you will follow. Now, if you have looked it properly, you can see that how you should keep it in your head. In your head, you will think when you get this kind of question that first I will go in I will ask the vitals from the examiner. Then I will start with the three syncopal question, pre-syncope, syncope, and post-syncope. After that, I will ask the DD question, CNS, CVS, and others. Then I will finish with past medical history, SADMA, and family history. This thing needs to be in your head when you go into the room. And that's the idea of having a format. Without a format, the exam pressure becomes so intense that you will be totally blank. And if you go in blank, it becomes very messy case. And then the examiner don't like it and you fail the exam. So what I ask everyone to do is that there should be a format in your head before going into the room, that this is how you're going to do this case. Okay? If your history is good, you will pass the exam, because history is the main thing for managing a case and managing a patient altogether. So history should be very important. Okay? Moving on to the physical examination from examiner. There are two kinds of physical examination that you will get in the exam. One is this one, which comes with the questions like history, physical examination from examiner, diagnosis, and DD. Physical examination from examiner means that you will just ask from the examiner the findings of the physical examination. Okay, so in physical examination from examiner, you just ask finding and examiner will give you whatever you ask. They will only give you exactly what you are asking from them, nothing extra. So if you miss something very important, they will not give it to you. This is one type of physical examination. There is another physical examination, which is solely a physical examination case only, in which you will have to do the physical examination on a person or on a role player in the exam. So, and in those cases, the task is like this. Like a 70-year-old patient coming to you with low back pain, you need to do physical examination and give your diagnosis and DD. In those cases, there will be no history, just physical examination. So you will have to do physical examination on them and then give your diagnosis and DD. We will not do the physical examination anytime soon at the moment. It will be in our course in the next 1 to 2 months. Then you will learn about it much detail. So let's talk about physical examination from examiner. In face-to-face exam, this is the usual format. You will have to ask physical examination finding from examiner. In online examination, they most of the time give a physical examination card. So a card where all the findings are written will be shown on the screen. And you just read it, get your finding, and go to the next task. But in face-to-face, it's a little tricky because you will need to ask everything. In very few cases, sometimes even in face-to-face, they can give you a physical examination card in the exam. So how we do this physical examination from examiner? So first of all, you finished your history here, right? And after you have finished that, you say that, thank you so much, Sam, for all the information. Now, I would like to ask some physical examination finding from my examiner. Please excuse me for a moment. After that, you turn to the examiner and say, dear examiner, I would like to do physical examination on my patient. I would like to start with general appearance. Is my patient, or does my patient look comfortable or in distress? Now, next, after general appearance, we ask about pickled. Pickled is a part of a mnemonic. We don't ask all the pickled in everywhere, just the relevant pickled. So what does this pickled means? Pickled, one is pallor, that's for anemia. I for icterus or jaundice. Then you have C for cyanosis. You have K for clubbing, although it should be C. L for lymphadenopathy. E for edema. D for dehydration. So pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymph node, edema, and dehydration. That's what makes pickled. Now, for a cardiovascular case, what is important pickle? Pallor is important because anemia is one of your differential diagnoses. You could ask about cyanosis. You could ask about edema or dehydration, right? So for cardiovascular system, you can ask that, I would like to know the general appearance of my patient. Does he look comfortable or in distress? Is there any pallor, cyanosis, edema, or dehydration? I would like to know the vitals. Now, if the examiner did not give you the vitals initially, then now in here, you will ask in detail. So ask all the blood pressure, pulse, respiratory rate, saturation. Ask the BMI of the patient. Now, it's not very important for a syncope case, but I always keep vitals and BMI together because in many cases, BMI plays an important role. So in this particular syncope cluster, BMI is not important, but keep vitals BMI at the same time just to remember it. For CVS, we will start with the neck first. In the neck, you are mainly looking for any raised JBP and if there is any carotid bruit. For CVS, CVS will be your main system in here. The main system, you will need to ask detail like inspection, palpation, auscultation. After that, you will go for the CNS because CNS is also your next system to look for. And then you will say you would like to finish with all other systemic examination, including respiratory system and abdominal examination. And lastly, we finish with office test, which I'm going to come in a moment, okay? Now let me discuss how you are supposed to do it in the exam. So I will just show you. So you will say that, dear examiner, I would like to do physical examination on my patient. I would like to know the general appearance. Is my patient comfortable or in distress? Examiner says your patient looks comfortable. Is there any pallor, cyanosis, edema, or dehydration? Examiner will say negative. I would like to know the vitals, blood pressure and pulse. Examiner give you the blood pressure pulse. I would also like to know the temperature, respiratory rate, and oxygen saturation. I would like to start with the neck first. Is there any raised JVP or carotid bruit present? Examiner says negative. I would like to focus on the whole body, but you can say I would like to do full systemic examination from head to toe, but first focus on cardiovascular system. On inspection, is there any visible cardiac impulse? No. Examiner says no. On palpation, is the apex beat normal in position? Any palpable thrill? Any parasternal heave or palpable P2? On auscultation, apart from S1 and S2, is there any added sound like any murmur? Examiner says no. After that, I would like to do the full central nervous system examination, including the cranial nerves, especially focusing on inspection, tone, power, reflex, sensation, and coordination. We follow the mnemonic ITPRCS, that's inspection, tone, power, reflex, coordination, and sensation. That's the nervous system examination. After that, I would like to finish with all other systemic exam, including respiratory system and abdominal examination. You don't need to ask anything in those systems, just say you would like to do that. Is there any office test available, examiner? I would like to know about urine dipstick, blood sugar level, and the electrocardiogram or ECG. Now, office test means that something which is readily available in the bedside. So what could be the bedside test that you can do in the hospital setting or GP setting? Okay, so you are mainly looking for urine dipstick. You are looking for blood sugar level and also ECG. Okay, just give me 1 minute and then we will again restart. Okay, just 1 minute. Thank you. All right. Sorry for that. So we are discussing about the physical examination from examiner, right? And we came up to office test. So the office test is mainly the test that we do in the bedside. In the bedside, we do, usually there are a couple of tests that can be done. One is urine dipstick, one is blood sugar level, one is electrocardiogram, especially for severe cases, not for everything. In some other cases, we can also do arterial or venous blood gas. We can sometimes do urine pregnancy test. And sometimes you can also do a spirometry. Okay? So those are the usual office tests that you can ask in the exam. And it should be relevant always, not everything. Like for this case, urine dipstick does not play a very huge role. Might be like you might get special, like some unrelated thing. Like for this case, if a patient is, let's say, having infective endocarditis, that patient can lose some blood in their urine. That's one thing you can look for. If the patient is diabetic, they can lose ketone or glucose in the urine. So not super important, but you can always ask it. But very important is blood sugar and electrocardiogram. So those will be the most two important ones, okay? So office test, we should always just ask it at the end of our physical examination. Never ever ask like ultrasound or X-ray in the office test. Those are investigations that cannot be done as a bedside. Like we can do chest X-ray as a bedside, but for the exam purpose, just forget about it, okay? So this will be physical examination for almost all the cardiology cases. So general appearance, pickled, vitals and BMI, neck for JVP and carotid bruit, CVS inspection, palpation, auscultation. In the inspection, visible cardiac impulse. You're looking for the position of the apex beat, any palpable thrill for murmur, any parasternal heave or palpable P2 for right ventricular hypertrophy. Apart from S1, S2, you're looking for any other sound like murmur. Sometimes we also look for pericardial rub or pericarditis. And then you are doing the CNS, other system, you just ask, you don't need to ask in detail, and then finish with office test. Hang the examiner and then come back to the patient and explain the condition in detail. So this will be your syncope cluster format. Now we will use this format for solving some of the cases, okay? Do you guys have any question? And yes, Dr. Jarin, other system you just mentioned that you would like to stand, you don't need to perform it. Which exam is easier, face-to-face or online? It totally depends. Like if you think that your English is very good, you can talk fluently, online exam is much better. But if that's the problem, then face-to-face is better. There is nothing you will be looking for in the physical examination in prolonged QT interval. You can't get anything in the physical exam. So that's a finding you can only get in the ECG. Moving on to our case, aortic stenosis. Before giving the break, let's do this case first. So you are a GP and your next patient is 52 years old male who is consulting about recent loss of consciousness. You have to take focused history, physical examination from examiner, ask or order necessary investigation and give your diagnosis and management. In exam, you don't get everything. Sometimes you will just get history, PEFE, diagnosis and differential diagnosis. Sometimes history, diagnosis and differential diagnosis. Sometimes history, physical examination card will be given to you. You just need to explain the diagnosis with the initial management. So it's not everything that comes in the task in exam, usually 3 or 4 tasks, sometimes 2, okay? The positive points in this case was patient was playing tennis and then started to black out This is not the first time it happened. For the last 2 months, he also got exertional dyspnea. He also felt chest tightness or pain. So this is the triad, right? Chest pain, dyspnea, and blackout or loss of consciousness or syncope. There's the triad of aortic stenosis. In the physical examination, you got left apical impulse is displaced and forceful. Now, this is the main important finding, because if it is a valvular problem, you will get a murmur, right? So the murmur that you will get in AS patient is ejection systolic murmur in the aortic area, which can radiate to the neck or carotid region. Now, what happens in here that when you come to the auscultation part of PEFE, if we go back, in the auscultation, when you ask about any added sound like any murmur, examiner can just say, yes, there is a murmur. Will you stop there? No. He will ask in detail. So examiner, I would like to know the type of the murmur, location of the murmur, and if it is radiating to anywhere. So type of the murmur means, is it a systolic or diastolic murmur? Let's say examiner says it's a systolic murmur in the aortic area. Will you stop there? No. Ask the examiner that, is it a pan-systolic murmur or ejection-systolic murmur? Because to say it is aortic stenosis, you need to know this. Because in case of aortic stenosis, the murmur will be ejection-systolic murmur. If it is a pan-systolic murmur, it becomes mitral regurgitation. So your diagnosis should be different at that time. So always make sure you ask it, even if examiner does not give you at one go. That's a trick in the exam. They don't give you if you don't ask it. So ask it, like if examiner say, yes, there is a murmur, you should ask that, dear examiner, I would like to know the type and location of the murmur. That should be fine. And sometimes with that, examiner can give you everything. If they don't, then you ask, is it a systolic or diastolic murmur? Examiner says systolic murmur. Is it an ejection systolic murmur or hollow systolic murmur or pan systolic murmur? Examiner says ejection systolic. Can I please ask that, is it radiating to anywhere? Okay, so remember this, because if you don't remember it, you will not understand that they are giving you aortic stenosis. Once you know about it, then you go for your exploration. So see that we did not do history and physical examination at all for this case, because we already know the history format, you already know, physical examination format, you already know. Only thing that you need to remember is the explanation. And explanation also, we try to use the same kind of format so that you can remember. Now, let's say your task is to explain the diagnosis and differential diagnosis. Never ever go extra. Like if diagnosis and differential diagnosis is in your task, you don't need to talk about investigation or management. Okay? So only cover what is written in the task, because they will mark you only on that. If you say a lot of things, then they will not give you extra mark. So forget about it. Rather, they might feel that you did not bother about the task and you just memorized a note and then vomited it out, which is not good. So explain in here. So thank you so much for waiting, Sam. Now, from the history and physical examination, I am suspecting that you might have a condition called aortic stenosis. Or most likely from history and physical examination, you are having a condition called aortic stenosis. Many times candidates say, you have a condition called aortic stenosis. As a junior doctor in Australia, you should not be very sure always, like not confirm, because you can't confirm it unless you do an echocardiogram. So in these cases, always we use the term that most likely, or I am suspecting. So that means you are giving a provisional diagnosis, not confirmatory diagnosis. So most likely from history and physical examination, you are having a condition called aortic stenosis. Do you know what it is? No, doctor. Well, don't worry. Let me draw a picture for your better understanding. So we always try to draw a picture in our explanation so that it becomes easier for the patient. So very quickly you can draw that this is your, let's say this is your heart, and your heart has four chambers. These are the upper two chambers, these are the lower two chambers. Each of these chambers has a door-like structure called valve. In your case, the valve that controls the flow of blood from the left side of your heart to the aorta, which is the big blood pipes supposed to supply all blood in your body, known as aortic valve, has been narrowed. Okay, so your drawing will make it easier. Otherwise, they will not understand anything that you are saying. So what we say, this is your heart. Your heart has four chambers, two upper, two lower chamber, and each of these chambers has a door-like structure called valve. Remember one thing, your explanation should be very simple. You can't use any medical jargon in your explanation. If you, like, obviously we are using a lot of medical jargon, aortic stenosis, valve, but we are explaining it. As long as you explain your medical jargon, you are fine. So in your case, the valve that controls the flow of blood from heart to aorta, known as aortic valve, is narrowed. And you can then explain that aorta is your big blood pipes that carry blood from your heart to the whole body. Now, because this valve has been narrowed, the blood supply to the brain is being reduced, and that's causing the loss of consciousness. And also, when you exercise, the demand of oxygen from your heart gets increased. But because it is already narrowed, it cannot supply enough blood and oxygen. And that's the reason you get chest pain and difficulty breathing during exertion or any kind of exercise. See the explanation? The most important part of your explanation is correlating the patient's symptom with your explanation. A patient needs to understand why I get loss of consciousness. A patient needs to understand why I get chest pain and difficulty breathing when I am playing. Only that time patient will feel that this doctor, whatever this doctor is saying, he or she knows about it or something making sense. Okay, but you obviously you will not go for explanation of a migraine pathophysiology. It doesn't make sense for you as well. So don't go for too much detail, but only the detail a patient needs to know is their symptom, how their symptom is happening. They need to know that because your valve is narrowed, the blood supply to the brain is getting reduced. And if brain does not get blood supply or oxygen, you will get loss of consciousness. And because when you are exercising, your demand of oxygen and blood is increased, but your valve is already narrowed. So your heart is not able to supply enough blood during those time. And that's the reason you get chest pain and shortness of breath. Once you explain it, say to the patient, are you with me so far? Did you understand? Yes, doctor. Now, apart from this, it could be other causes as well. Now, let's say your task was diagnosis and DD. In that case, nothing in here will be needed. So you just forget about it. You will say that it could be due to other causes as well. Then you think about all the differential diagnoses and explain why it is not your diagnosis. So let's say your diagnosis, you will just say that, well, it could be due to other causes as well. Like it could be myocardial infarction or heart attack, but you don't have any chest pain, any difficulty breathing right now. And also, we will arrange some investigations to rule that out. It could be due to some other arrhythmia-related problem or heart rhythm disturbances, but you don't get any racing of the heart. Okay? It could be due to some nervous system-related problem like a stroke or transient ischemic attack, but you don't have any weakness, blurring of vision, or speech problem. Could be head injury, but you did not injure your head. Could be infection of the brain, but you don't have fever, chest fever, neck stiffness, or headache. It could be due to some other causes like vasovagal syncope, but you did not have any particular symptoms related to that. It could be due to postural hypertension, but you don't feel dizzy when you change your position. It could be hypoglycemia or low blood sugar, but you did not skip your meal before having any of this incident. So all these causes are very unlikely. See that the way you show your differential diagnosis, it shows that this doctor knows what he or she is doing. And examiner love this kind of explanation, it's actually a really good idea that you're making reason in your head and then discussing it with the patient. Patient feels very confident when you do something like that. All right. So that's how we give our differential diagnosis in the exam. Let's say your task was explain the diagnosis and further management. So for further management, what you would like to do, this patient is in the GP setting, send the patient to the hospital because the patient is getting frequent symptoms. Say that as part of the management, I would like to send you to the hospital. In the hospital, you will be admitted and you will be seen by a cardiologist. They will do some investigation like full blood examination, your kidney function, inflammatory marker. They will do an electrocardiogram of your heart to rule out any changes. They might also want to do a chest X-ray and an echocardiogram, which will confirm if your valve is actually narrowed. The echocardiogram is just like an ultrasound scan, which will look into the inside of your heart, especially for any valve problem. The further management will depend on this echocardiogram report and how much narrowing of your valve has happened, and also according to the severity of your condition. The specialist will discuss in detail about further management. The management can be conservative approach where they will just regularly review you. Sometimes they might also want to do some valve replacement therapy. But if it's the case, then they will discuss in detail with you about the next procedure. Once you are stable and discharged from the hospital, I would like to follow you up about what happened in the hospital. Please try to avoid any strenuous exercise or activities for now and adopt a healthy lifestyle. I'll give you some reading materials. You can read it on the way to your hospital. Thank you. Do you have any questions? Okay. So when we finish a case, we follow an approach which we call 4R. 4R means review, refer, red flags, reading materials. So red flags, in here you are sending a patient to the hospital, so you don't need to give them any red flag because in the hospital they will talk about it. Review, you say that after hospital discharge you would like to review him. You already referred the patient to the hospital and you have given some reading materials. So this is how we finish a case: a review, red flag, refer, and reading material. All right? So that's how your aortic stenosis case should be done. Any question, guys? So should we draw during online examination as well or only face-to-face? Only face-to-face. For online exam, there is no need of drawing. You can't actually draw it. That's the main issue. So no need of drawing in online exam. Yes, if task is in management, investigation is a part of management. How to ask physical examination in online examination? Now, in online exam, they don't ask you to ask physical examination because in online exam, the examiner did not give you any finding. So examiner does not talk to you. Sometimes the task might say that explain to the examiner how are you going to do the physical examination, and after that, a card will appear on the screen. Now, if that is the case, you will just explain what physical examination you are going to do in this patient. So in that case, you will say that, dear examiner, I would like to do physical examination on my patient. I would start with the general appearance first, looking for if my patient is comfortable or in distress. I would also look for any pallor, clubbing, lymph node, edema, or dehydration. I will check his vitals, so all the vitals. Start with the neck then, looking for any raised JVP or carotid bruit. Then I would start with the cardiovascular exam, then explain inspection, palpation, auscultation, then CNS, then other system, and then you would also do some office tests. So you just explain what you are going to do. Examiner will not give you finding like face-to-face, but once you are done, a card will appear on the screen and you will just read the finding and then move to your next task. Is this understandable? No need. You will not get that much time, Dr. Amal, to give a summary of the case before giving the diagnosis. There is no need. Examiner already looking that you are asking everything. It just take a lot of time. And also when you are explaining, you are talking about the positive symptoms anyway. No. Examination, physical examination, it's always from the examiner. Unless it is written in the task that explain what physical examination you are going to do with the patient. If with the patient, then only you will do that. Otherwise, physical examination should be directed towards the examiner. All good? So always read the task very carefully. In exam, everything is very clear. There will be no like confusion of the task. If they want you to do something with the patient, they will write it in there. The task will be very straightforward, okay? So no, read the task very carefully, because sometimes it's written in the task that explain the management with the examiner, but candidate just explaining it to the patient. Or vice versa, it is written in the task that explain your management with the patient and candidate explaining it to the examiner. You will fail, because if you are not doing the exact task, they can't mark you. Yes, on face-to-face exam, you might need to perform examination on the patient, not this kind of task. This task is called physical examination from examiner. So PEFE means that you just ask finding from the examiner. That's why it's called physical examination, finding from examiner. So you just ask finding and examiner gives you the finding. But there is a case where there is physical examination where you will have to perform examination on the patient in face-to-face, not in online exam. Yes, you can use pen and paper in online examination. Moving on to our next case, prolonged QT syndrome. A 19-year-old girl comes to the emergency department because she fell unconscious 2 days ago while she was climbing up a mountain. History of PEFE, investigation from examiner, diagnosis and management. So see, the task is written in here. History is always from the patient. Physical examination from examiner, investigation from examiner, diagnosis and management, always with the patient, unless it is specified in the task that explain it to the examiner. So this patient is a 19-year-old. You are in the ED setting, and she fell unconscious 2 days ago while she was climbing up a mountain. The positive finding in here is that patient was climbing up a mountain, then had a sudden loss of consciousness without a chair. That means that it is likely to be a cardiac origin. 3 episodes so far, And each of the time she was doing different things. There is no other symptoms like shortness of breath, chest pain, or palpitation. History of unknown heart disease in maternal uncle. So you can see that there is an unknown heart condition in the family. That's the time you should think about the either it's a possibility of HOCM or prolonged QT syndrome. So that's your findings. You know the history format already. Physical examination, you already know. You will mainly look for the same thing. You will not get anything in the physical exam. Everything will be normal. But when you ask the investigations from examiner, you will ask for ECG, right? And in the ECG, you will get the finding. So this will be how the ECG looks like. Now, today we are not going for ECG discussion. The next cardiology class will be a little bit more towards ECG discussion. So let's go a little bit so that you have some idea about it. A normal ECG, and I'm sure that all of you already have some idea about ECG because you had to do it for MCQ anyway. So normal ECG have this component, right? So you get your P wave followed by QRST. It's the T wave, right? And this is your isoelectric line. This is called PR interval, right? That's your QRS complex. For prolonged QT syndrome, the main important thing, what is the QT interval? QT interval is starting of the Q wave and finishing of the T wave. So that's your QT interval. In a normal ECG, QT interval should be between 8 to 11 small square. Okay, so 8 to 11 square, small square is the normal QT interval finding. But if it is more than 11 small square, that's the time we call about prolonged QT syndrome. When you get an ECG in the exam, how to read an ECG to the examiner, we will discuss it in our next class when we will have palpitation cluster. But tonight, just make sure that in an ECG, you have chest lead and limb lead. Lead 1, 2, 3, AVR, AVL, AVF. These are your limb leads. And V1 to V6, all of them are chest leads. There is a long lead. You can see, right? It's a very long lead. And that's your lead 2. So this lead 2, now in here to show you any kind of arrhythmia problem. So if you're looking for any arrhythmia related causes, look in the long lead. And long lead is usually given at the end of the ECG. If you're looking for any myocardial infarction, look for any ST elevation in the chest lead or limb lead. Now for this case, you already know it's a syncope case. And if you first look at V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. First thing that I always look in the ECG is that if there is any ST changes. So that's your P, this is QRST. Now this is your ST wave, right? And you can see it's in the isoelectric line. If it was a ST elevation, this one would go here. Same with this one. This is still in the isoelectric line. But if ST elevation, it would go like this. So there is no ST elevation, so it's unlikely to be an MI. And quickly also look on lead 1, 2, everything. You will find out there is nothing wrong in here. Then come to the long lead. In the long lead, you're looking for if there is any tachycardia. So you are looking for heart rate in between 2 RR interval, right? And you can see that this is a regular rhythm, right? So if it is a regular rhythm, it's unlikely to be atrial fibrillation. You're looking for any supraventricular tachycardia, but in supraventricular tachycardia, one, that there will be tachycardia, right? In here, you can see that it's unlikely to be tachycardia because there are 4 larger square. In a 4 larger square, heart rate is normal, right? So it's unlikely to be a tachycardia. Even if it's a supraventricular tachycardia, this P wave should not be here. So if it is a P wave is here, it's not SVT. The questions which come in exam is usually atrial fibrillation or flutter, supraventricular tachycardia. You already ruled out, right, everything. Now, when you come to a point where nothing is positive, then you look at the QT interval. So in the QT interval, if we look here, so that's the start of Q, and this is the end of T, right? Now, if we look at here, this is 5 small square, another 5 small square, so 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So this QT interval, at least you can say 14 to 15 small square, right? And we know that if it is more than 11 small square, it's prolonged QT syndrome. So that's the time. Now you think that this is most likely a prolonged QT syndrome case, okay? In exam, to make it much shorter, if you're having chest pain, even don't bother about looking at the chest lead first. Look at the long lead first. Look for any arrhythmia like atrial fibrillation or SVT. If not, then look for the QT interval prolongation, okay? So that's how you quickly read ECG in exam. We will come to much detail about it in our next class. And also how to explain ECG to the examiner that comes in exam, we will discuss about it in the next session. So when you explain this prolonged QT syndrome, how we do that? So say that most likely from history and physical exam, you have got a condition called prolonged QT syndrome. Do you know what it is? No, doctor. Well, let's discuss in detail. As you can see that we put some leads on your chest earlier and we recorded your electrical activity of the heart. And that is what we call as electrocardiogram or in short ECG. Now in the ECG, there will be some lines that can show any changes of rhythm in your heart. Let me draw a picture. So this is your heart, and your heart has electrical activity to pump the blood. The ECG has different parts which represents different components of this activity. In your case, the part that we call QT interval is markedly prolonged, and that is what we call as prolonged QT interval. This condition is commonly associated with abnormal heart rhythm, resulting in impaired pumping of blood, causing frequent collapse, like in your case. See that how simple it is now, but if you go in detail, like what is QT interval, what is ECG, if you explain a lot, patient will be very confused. The only thing patient needs to know is that why I am getting collapse. I'm just a 19-year-old girl, right? So why I'm getting collapsed when I am climbing a mountain, or why I am losing consciousness when I'm just sitting. So that's what the patient wants to know. So you will just say that we have done ECG of your heart, which is the electrical recording of your heart. Your heart has electrical activity to pump the blood to the whole body. And the ECG has different parts which represents different component of this. In your case, the part that we call as QT interval is markedly prolonged, and that is what we call as prolonged QT syndrome. This condition is associated with abnormal heart rhythm, resulting in impaired pumping of blood, especially to your brain, and that's the reason why you are getting frequent collapse. It could be due to other causes as well. Now you can give some differential diagnosis in here, just like before. Then if management is a task, you can say that sometimes this condition can run in the family. Sometimes it can be due to some medication, sometimes could be dehydration, sometimes could be salt and water imbalance. Unfortunately, this condition can cause serious consequences. That's why I would like to admit you in the hospital and call the heart specialist to review you. But please don't get scared because you are in a safe hand and we will do our best to manage your condition. Always reassure the patient, because if you say that this is an emergency condition or serious condition to a 19-year-old, they will die there, like out of fear, right? So don't scare them too much. But again, you will have to send your message to them. You can't withhold information. You will have to say that this is a serious condition, but you are in a safe hand and we will do everything possible to our hand to make sure your symptoms are fine. The specialist might do few investigations like full blood examination, your kidney function, liver function, thyroid function, blood sugar level, and an echocardiogram of your heart, which is a scan on your heart to see that if your heart function is fine. Once this is done, the specialist might manage you with a medication called beta blocker, but if that fails, he might need to put you on a special cardiac or heart instrument. You can say your specialist might put you on some special heart device. You don't need to say cardiac pacing, just say special heart device. But all of these things will depend on your investigations and your symptoms, and the specialist will discuss it in detail. If all the investigations come normal and we can't find any cause, then most likely it is a congenital prolonged QT syndrome, which means that you got it by birth and likely that it runs in your families. In that case, we might need to arrange a family screening by doing ECG on other family members. Once everything is done and you have got a management plan, they will discharge you from the hospital. I will also, you can say in here that once everything is done, then we will discharge you from the hospital. We will write a letter to your GP who will follow you up regularly. And then at the end, always finish with something nice and good, like say that, Jenny, I understand that it is very overwhelming for you. You are 19-year-old, and I'm saying to you that you might have got a heart condition. It must be very exhausting and even sometimes scary for you. But please let me assure you that this is not an uncommon condition to get. And we have very good cardiologist in this hospital who is going to take care of you. If you would like me to call your friends, your family members, we would love to do that. If you have any questions at any time, please don't hesitate to ask me again. Okay, so finishing should be very nice so that the examiner feels that you actually care for your patient, and also patient feels that this doctor is not just talking, but is meaning it, right? Whatever is coming out of your mouth should have some meaning. And never ever think that this is just an exam. Think that this is your real patient. Only that time you will be able to pass the exam. If you think that this is just an exam and my job is to finish the task in time, that's wrong. It's not only that, it's about how passionate you are, okay? All right, now I think we should take a 10-minute break because I might be giving you a lot of information at one time. Please take a 10-minute break, and after that, we will finish this cluster, okay? Cool, any question? You guys are liking the approach? You guys understanding me? Very good. Okay, so let's take a 10-minute break then, and then we will start again. Thank you. All right, everyone, this is start again. Okay, the next case that we are going to discuss is postural hypotension. Postural hypotension is very, very important for your exam, and it can come in a lot of ways. So this is one of them, like a middle-aged woman comes with dizziness for the last several days. So it can come as dizziness, or sometimes it can come as a fall, like a 65-year-old comes to see you because he had a fall yesterday. So take history, physical examination, diagnosis, and DD. The positive points in this case is that patient feels dizzy when standing from a sitting or lying position. So that's the main thing that you will be looking for in the history. So especially if patient says that mainly it happens in the morning, then you will think that, well, if it is happening in the morning, does it happen when you change your position from lying to sitting or sitting to standing position? You will get positive finding. Patient can say that a lot of things, like I feel dizzy, I feel unsteady, I feel lightheadedness, so anything can be. Now, time to time, this might be the only thing. So when you get a patient with postural hypotension, it's not just the end of it. You need to find out why this patient is getting postural hypotension. So you'll be looking for some causes. Some causes, like it might be due to some, if patient is dehydrated, like patient had a recent heavy vomiting, diarrhea, or patient might be having sepsis or infection at the moment. You might be also looking for any electrolyte imbalance, which also same like any vomiting, severe sweating, any diarrhea recently. Other than that, very important finding is that if patient is on any medication, which can be volume depleting, like this patient is on diuretics and ACE inhibitor. If you ask in more deeper way, you might find that maybe patient recently increased the dose of it, or maybe patient was on ACE inhibitor before. Now, because blood pressure is not well controlled or patient ankle is swollen, the doctor has started diuretics. And after that, he's having this symptom. So something you will find out in the history, which will lead you to think that this is the cause of having volume depletion feature, which is coming as postural hypotension. Some patient can get autonomic neuropathy, especially for a diabetes patient, they can get autonomic neuropathy, and postural hypotension can be a symptom of that. So in this case, you have found the patient is diabetic for many, many years, but it is well controlled. Controlled, then you are not thinking about autonomic neuropathy. But if it is not well controlled, then you might be looking for any other features, like if patient has got any diabetic complication, like problem with vision, any tingling, numbness in the lower leg, any problem with their heart, okay? So those kind of diabetic complication you might be able to find. Some other autonomic neuropathy features could be heartburn. Patient might have like a early gastric fullness. Your patient might have sexual dysfunction, okay? So those kind of features you will be looking for in the history to find out if the patient having any diabetic autoneuropathy. Now that's very complicated. You don't need to think about it too much. It does not come in exam like this. You might be also looking for if the patient losing blood from anywhere, especially for a 60-year-old, you'll be looking for any occult blood loss in the stool. So ask the patient that if you are having, have you noticed any change in your bowel habit? Have you noticed any blood in your stool? So those will be the main thing that you will be looking for. So in this case, the patient coming to you with having a fall yesterday or dizziness yesterday. So your history will be same like before. You just make sure that what happened before fall, during fall, and after fall, okay? And the differential diagnosis questions will be same. Just when you find out that patient saying that I feel dizzy when I'm changing position, then you will be asking some cause of postural hypotension. So you'll be asking that, have you had any recent vomiting or diarrhea? Are you feeling unwell recently, like any flu-like illness, any fever, any infection that you are having at the moment. Ask about any medical condition. You might find out patient is diabetic. Find out about diabetes, that is it, how long you are having diabetes. Is it well controlled? What are you taking for it? Okay. Ask about change in bowel habit, any blood in the stool. So those will be your main questions. You also ask about any medication you are taking and find out all the medication that he is taking. Find out if any dose of the medication recently has been increased or any new medication has been added. So that will give you the more perspective about the cause of postural hypertension. After that, your physical examination, everything will be normal. But in the vitals, when you will ask about blood pressure in both standing and sitting position, then you will find out patient having a postural drop. Like when we called about postural drop, like let's say 130 by 90 is your sitting position. So sitting blood pressure is 130 by 90. But when patient stand, it's 110 by 80. So we say that if systolic blood pressure more than 20 or diastolic blood pressure more than 10 drops, when patient change their position from sitting to standing, that is what we call as postural hypertension. Okay. So that's the only finding you might get in the physical exam. Now, apart from that case, there are some other questions. Like sometimes patient says that patient was sitting in a chair while standing from sitting position, patient collapsed. So that might be one of the history that they give in the exam. Another can be patient was taking risperidone for psychiatric problem and now coming with dizziness. Risperidone is an antipsychotic medication, and it is notorious to cause postural hypotension. So this will be drug-induced postural hypotension. So anything can come, but you need to find out what's causing it. So in here, you are finding out the diagnosis and the cause of the diagnosis. So that's why it's really important for exam. So for the first case, you can say that most likely from history and physical exam, you are having a condition called postural hypotension. Do you know what it is? No, doctor. Well, this is a condition in which there is sudden drop of blood pressure when you change your position from lying or sitting to a standing position. It could be due to many reasons like severe vomiting, diarrhea, high fever, strenuous exercise. But in your case, most likely it is due to the multiple medications you have been taking. If you get any finding like a dose has been increased or a new medication has been added, just add it in your explanation. Also, as you are diabetic, it could be due to another condition called diabetic autoneuropathy, which can manifest as heartburn, bloating, diarrhea, constipation, difficulty with urination, and sexual dysfunction. But as your blood sugar is well controlled, it is less likely to be the reason. This type of dizziness or fall could be due to other reasons, like heart rhythm disturbance, but you don't have any racing of your heart. Could be a structural heart defect, heart attack, but you don't have any chest pain, difficulty breathing, and then explain all of the others. Okay, so that's usually the diagnosis and DD comes in exam. If they ask for management, then just do some basic investigation, full blood count, inflammatory marker, urea electrolyte, blood sugar, liver function, kidney function, and the ECG. The further management will be that you will need to consult with the specialist to review the medication to change or reduce the dose. So if it is medication-induced postural hypertension, you can consult with the specialist who has started the medication, or you as a GP also can change or reduce the dose, okay? So that's one of the case that come as a postural hypertension. Now, the second case, the risperidone-induced postural hypotension, the same thing, but the explanation will be like, most likely from history and physical exam, you have got a condition called postural hypotension. This condition is characterized by a change of your blood pressure when you stand up from a sitting position, and that gives you dizziness. There are two possibilities. Either you are having a side effect of the risperidone that you're taking for your psychiatric problem, or a higher than normal dose has been taken. This side effect is quite commonly seen within the first week of treatment, even at a normal dose sometimes. When you sometimes say in the exam that it is medication causing the problem, patient can ask you, so did the doctor make a mistake to give me the medication? What should you say in order? Say that, well, I appreciate your concern. Your doctor has prescribed what is best for you. I would prefer to take a look at the prescription, and if possible, I will talk with your wife who takes care of your medication as well. Okay. Now, you can also say that your doctor has prescribed the best options for you, but sometimes patient can get side effects. Sometimes one person can maybe able to take one medication and someone else might have a lot of difficulty with that exact same preparation. It's how your body gets adjusted with a particular medication and its ingredient. But if this is the medication causing the problem, obviously we will manage you accordingly. So in this case, I'm going to keep you in the emergency department to observe your blood pressure and do this blood test. The blood test that we are going to arrange is the simple ones: full blood count, kidney function, liver function, blood sugar, and risperidone blood level. Also, I will call the psychiatric team to review your condition. They might adjust the dose of your current medication, or they might decide to switch to another one. If they decide to change, then you might need to stay in the hospital during this crossover period, which takes around 1 to 2 weeks' time. So that's how we manage it. If risperidone is the cause of this postural hypotension, then the management would be do those blood tests, including the risperidone blood level, and either you reduce the dose or change it to something else. Meanwhile, I would like to aware of some general rules to be followed when you are having this kind of problem. So always take medication exactly as prescribed. Have a routine to take at the same time every day. If you forget to take a dose, take it within the next few hours. Otherwise, skip the dose. Please never do double the dose. You need to continue taking the medication even if you feel well, and never stop the drug abruptly. If you develop side effects, then yes, you will inform your doctor just like you have done today. There is a half minute rule which you can follow. When you get up in the morning, sit up slowly and then stay there for 30 seconds. Put the legs over the side of the bed, keep it for 30 seconds, and then slowly get up and walk to prevent any dizziness in the future. So this half minute rule for anyone who is feeling dizzy first thing in the morning when they are changing position. So you can explain this to anyone with postural hypotension. Okay, so that's the management. Normally, management does not come in exam. They just want to find out the diagnosis and the reason of having this problem. Any question with this case, guys? Well, moving on to vasovagal syncope, another important case for your exam. 18-year-old girl fainted during marathon, and that was the annual sport. Now fully recovered, and mother is here to consult with you. So 18-year-old girl fainted during marathon. That is something like you think about possibility of vasovagal, because marathon is a very strenuous sport, and most of the time it might be a hot sunny weather, and that can cause this vasovagal syncope. The positive point in the history was girl fainted during running, and it was a hot sunny day, Also, when you ask the differential diagnosis question, you might find out that the before running, she skipped the breakfast also. So that gives you two possibilities, that either it's a hypoglycemic attack or it might be a vasovagal syncope. And when you ask the office test, you found blood sugar 3.6 millimole per liter. If blood sugar less than 4 millimole per liter, that's hypoglycemia. Now, that means that your patient is still hypoglycemic. This is a tricky thing in the exam. If you see that a patient's blood sugar less than 4, immediately offer that patient some sugar drink, jelly beans, honey, anything that has sugar in it. So you will just say to the examiner that, like, when you ask the blood sugar level in the office test, examiner says 3.6 millimole per liter. You will say that, dear examiner, as my patient seems to be in hypoglycemia currently, I would like to offer her a glucose drink, like a glass of, you can say that, like 6 jelly beans or honey or some sugar drinks. Examiner usually look for that. If you don't offer a glucose drink, you might fail the case also. Okay? So that's one of the other important findings. So explain in here that the temporary loss of consciousness that your daughter experienced during marathon running today is known as syncope. There are many reasons which can cause it, but in your child case, I am suspecting two possibilities. One is called vasovagal syncope. In this condition, in response to certain trigger, such as overexerting in a hot sunny weather, can stimulate a nerve in the body, which can cause pooling of blood in the lower legs. Because of pooling of blood in the legs, it can lead to decreased return of blood towards the heart and thereby less blood supply towards the brain. And that's the reason if brain is compromised of blood and oxygen, it can lead to sudden faintness and collapse, just like your girl. Please don't get scared about the term of it, because it's a very common cause of fainting and there is nothing to worry about. Another condition that also can precipitate this attack is hypoglycemia or low blood sugar. Because your daughter skipped the breakfast before running and then she had to run the marathon in a hot sunny weather, that can also lead to a low blood sugar, which can cause the similar problem. I have also measured the blood sugar here, which we have found as low, and we have offered some glucose drink to increase the blood sugar level. It could be due to other causes as well, then give all other differential diagnosis. Okay? Sometimes in this case, you can get 3-4 causes at the same patient. Like in here, you have got two causes, right? Vasovagal and hypoglycemia. Sometimes in the physical exam, they add pallor. Why pallor positive in an 18-year-old? If you are very tricky, you might ask in the question that, have you started your menstruation? 18-year-old usually will have their menstruation. When was your last menstrual period? Do you get regular period? Any excessive bleeding during period? Now, excessive bleeding during period can cause pallor because of iron deficiency anemia. And if a patient is already iron deficient, that can also cause syncopal attack. So look for these things in the exam, because sometimes they just add a small thing and people just miss it. And if they miss it, they miss a particular point on that case and then they fail. Even though they think that they have done everything, but still they fail because something is missing or something they haven't asked, okay? Cool, so that was your vasovagal syncope. Now you guys have noticed that we have just done one history and one physical examination format, and we have done this whole number of cases just with that exact one format. That's the beauty of this kind of cluster-wise approach, okay? Because you don't need to learn anything extra. You are just having a one format in your head and you know 5-6 cases. Like if we can do the whole preparation, think that how much concise your preparation will be. Okay. Now, the last case for tonight will be recurrent fall. Recurrent fall, we also put it under the syncope cluster, but we add a little bit more. So recurrent fall is important. It comes in exam frequently. When recurrent fall is the case, the differential diagnosis should include all the other causes, like you will obviously rule out CVS, CNS cause. You will rule out other causes like vasovagal, postural hypotension. You will rule out endocrine cause like diabetes, which will include hypoglycemia or other diabetic complication like diabetic retinopathy or neuropathy. Electrolyte abnormality due to vomiting, diarrhea, anemia. Polypharmacy is very, very important cause of recurrent fall. Also, recurrent fall is usually the case for elderly patients. And their home situation, their vision and hearing can lead to further fall. And some, and not some, most of them will have some osteoarthritic or some joint problem, which will limit their mobility and can cause fall. So home situation, mainly you're looking for any loose carpet in the house, maybe lack of a hand railing in their stair, or maybe they're having, let's say, like poor lighting in their house. So all of this needs to be fixed so that they don't get a recurrent fall. Okay, so you're looking for those home situations problems, and vision, hearing and joint problem is also important to rule out. So those are all the differential diagnoses for recurrent fall. So in here, again, your history should be, first of all, ask about the fall. So I'm very sorry that you had the fall recurrently. It must be very difficult for you, but now that you are here, I'm going to take care of it. So please tell me a little bit more about these episodes. How many episodes have you had so far? What exactly were you doing in each time? So first of all, ask an open-ended question and then just find out all the episodes of fall. Find out the particular details that can help you that where exactly is the problem. Okay. Then a recent fall in detail. So the recent fall, before fall, what happened, during fall, what happened, and after fall. Same questions. DD, CVS, CNS, same questions. For postural hypotension, do you feel dizzy when you change your position? Ask about any fever, vomiting, diarrhea, any bleeding from anywhere. For anemia, do you feel fatigued and tired these days? Do you take healthy balanced diet? Past medical history is very important in here. Ask about how's your general health, any history of diabetes, stroke, high blood pressure, or any heart condition. Now, in this case, many times patient says, yes, I'm diabetic. So then you will need to go in detail of it. So say that how long you are diabetic, is it well controlled? Do you check your blood sugar regularly? Are you regular with your specialist? Are you taking any medication? If yes, which medication you are taking? Any problem with your vision? Any numbness, tingling sensation in your lower leg? So very important thing is that elderly patient whose diabetes is not controlled, they can develop diabetic retinopathy, they can develop diabetic neuropathy. If they can't see properly, they can fall. If they can't feel their legs, they will not know where they're stepping. They can fall, right? So it's a very important to rule those things out in these cases. Ask detail about medication. A lot of time, recurrent fall is just due to some polypharmacy. Ask about their home situation. So who do you live with? How is your home situation? Any loose carpet, any problem with lighting? Any joint problem, especially any joint pain or any problem with walking or keeping balance? Ask about SADMA, smoking, alcohol, any other recreational drugs? Ask about, do you have enough support at your home? A lot of elderly lives alone in here. And because of lack of support, it becomes very hard for them to live if they're having recurrent fall. So those situations, you might be thinking about either contacting with their relatives or their like son or daughter, or maybe even consider sending them to a nursing home because they're having recurrent fall, which is risky for them. So that's the recurrent fall history that you will need to ask, okay? In the physical examination, general appearance, vitals, in here we will ask eye in detail. So you would like to check the eye, especially looking for visual acuity, visual field, and also a fundoscopy. In the fundoscopy, examiner can say that there are features of diabetic retinopathy. That one of the findings you can get. Visual acuity can be reduced. CVS, CNS, and musculoskeletal system in detail. So CVS, apart from S1, S2, is there any added sound? The CNS should be done in detail. So I would like to do full central nervous system examination, including the cranial nerve in both upper and lower limbs. I would like to check tone, power, reflex, coordination, and sensation. When you say sensation, examiner can say that you have got GLOPS and Glovan stalking loss of sensation in the lower limb. Glovan stalking loss of sensation is peripheral neuropathy. In the musculoskeletal system, say that I would like to do full musculoskeletal system in the lower limb, especially any changes in the ankle, knee, or hip joint. And lastly, office test, BSL, and urine dipstick. In here, you can get blood sugar maybe 20. That will lead you to think that this is an uncontrolled diabetes, which has been complicated by peripheral neuropathy and diabetic retinopathy. And that's the cause of recurrent fall. So the positive points are this. Patient had 3 episodes so far. Diabetic for 10 years, having numbness, tingling, vision problem, knee joint pain. Patient also had a history of a stroke, but taking physio at the moment. Physical examination shows fundoscopy with retinopathy features, peripheral neuropathy positive, and BSL 16. So explain that from the history and physical exam, most likely the cause of your recurrent fall is uncontrolled blood sugar causing peripheral neuropathy and diabetic retinopathy. Let me explain it. In this condition, the nerves that supply your lower extremities get affected, which causes numbness and tingling. And that's why sometimes you may not feel where you have been stepping. Also, we have found some eye changes related to diabetes, which is affecting your vision. Other than this, you are also having knee joint changes, which can lead to recurrent fall as well. So all of this might be the reason which is causing your recurrent fall. But it could be due to other causes as well. Then just give other differential diagnosis. Okay, so that's how usually the recurrent fall cases come in the exam. Sometimes you might not get anything, but in the pulse rate, you have got sinus bradycardia. And they might give you an ECG showing bradycardia in the ECG. And just sinus bradycardia causing recurrent fall can be a case in the exam. So never ever just think that whatever you are reading, whatever you know, that will be the exam case. Exam case can be anything. You will have to have a good basic to find it out. Okay? So that finishes our cardiology lecture 1 for tonight. Any question? Okay. Now, as you guys understand that this is actually just similar like our 1 class. The classes are extensive like this. And we try our best to make sure you understand everything. You should not feel confused after having a class. That's the main deal. The next class will be on 17th December. So In that class, we will finish the cardiology class 2. Okay? These positive findings, the examiner will tell us once we ask him. From examiner, Dr. Firas, you will only get physical examination finding. The history finding, you will find it from the patient. And yes, the physical examination finding, only you will get it if you ask them. If you miss something, they will not give it to you. And yes, the lecture notes are in the dashboard. It's not very usual to get a solely counseling case in the syncope topic. Not very usual. In exam, anything can come. Okay, but I haven't seen anything like that. In SADMA, if you ask, do you smoke or drink alcohol? That's fine. You can even ask, like, do you smoke, drink alcohol, or any other recreational drugs? If you do that, that should not be a problem. Now, in the exam, Dr. Abdul, they will not say that your task is finished and start the next task. They don't say that. Okay, they give you just 8 minutes inside, and that's the time that you will get. They will not prompt you unless it is given in the task that take history for 4 minutes. Then after 4 minutes, there might be a bell. And you will need to think that this bell means 4 minutes is up. Okay. All right. So that should be all for tonight. Is there anything that you want to ask about the course or anything? What I would like to do is to go through the course detail once with you so that you guys have an idea and don't feel confused all the time. So let us go through the video. And then we can just have a look what the course has to offer. Okay, just give me 1 sec. And yes, all the class schedule that you have seen in your Facebook group, those are all free sessions. Okay, so let's have a look to our course detail. And then if you guys have any questions, feel free to ask me again. right? So that was all about the course, okay? So I hope that it explains a lot about your course questions. But still, if you have any questions, feel free to ask it here. We are more than happy to answer any questions. Yes, the notes will be accessible even until you pass the exam. Any questions for someone who is in the Facebook? Yes, the classes are all recorded. A lot of our doctors can't come in the online ones as a live sessions. So yes, they can always go through our recorded lectures. And for someone of you who wants to join the course, there are two ways. Either you can just inbox me in my messenger, or you can just email us in our email. So the email is in here, I think. This is the email ID. So you can just email in here to the outlook.com, or you can always inbox us. Any of these two is fine. Okay. So that should be all for tonight. Yes, the random role play notes will be in the dashboard. We normally take 24 hours to upload any classes in your portal. So you'll just need to wait until the next day to get all of those, okay? The old students, yes. Now, if you are ex-students, you can join our weekly role play classes with Dr. Cynthia. But if you want to join the full course again, you can also talk to us. And that has some discounted price for it, but just contact with us in that case. The role play free, like, if you actually are a regular student with us, you will get a huge opportunity to do role play, because a lot of our students are beginners. They don't want to do role play. But if you think that you want to do that, then usually they get a lot of chance. So if you were regular with the role play sessions, then most of the time you should be able to do role play with us. Maybe not every day, but obviously very frequently. Okay then, so that should be all for tonight. I hope you enjoyed the sessions with us. We'll see you in the next class. Good night.